apologize for running late.
I have to abstain from this first.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Again, I apologize for running late. I had things going crazy and one thing led to another. Anyway, this is the June meeting for the Valdosta Downs County Zoning Board of Appeals. For those of you that have never been here, especially since we have a large crowd, let me explain how it works so you can understand. I will call each case by case name and case number. Staff will come to the lectern and give us the request. After we have heard from staff, there is going to be probably discussions or questions among board members, staff, and among ourselves. Once we're satisfied and we understand the case, I will ask if the applicant or someone representing the applicant is here to give us any additional information. Please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record, and give us the information that you would like us to take under advisement. Once you have presented the information, then there will probably be questions or discussions among the board members concerning what we're looking at to make sure we all understand. If there are multiple people here in support, if you have information that you feel like has not been brought to us, please come to the lectern and give us the information. Please don't hammer us with the same thing again. Once we're satisfied, we have heard from the pro side, and I will ask if there are any persons here in opposition that wish to speak. Somebody come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record, give us the information you would like for us to take under advisement. There will be probably questions or discussions back and forth concerning what we're being given. If there are multiple people here in opposition, if your position, your information has already been given to us, please don't three or four or five of you come up here and hammer us. One time is enough. If you feel like something has not been brought to our attention that you would like for us to take under advisement, please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record and the information you would like for us to take into consideration. Okay, the first case that we'll call. Yes. The only thing that we will be dealing with here is variances. If there's anything to do with zoning that is not within our purview to handle anything or just to discuss, that would have to go before the Zoning and Planning Committee, Council, whatever. So if we're getting into something concerning zoning other than a variance, there's no need bringing it up because we can't act on it. Okay, first case is Lowndes County case VAR 201904. Knudsen or Knudsen and Son Outdoor Activities.
Relatives will reside in the existing single-family dwelling. and he desires to establish an outdoor recreation use, specifically an airsoft field in the rear of the home. After review of the ULDC's requirements to establish an outdoor recreation use, Mr. Knutson felt it necessary to seek relief through the variance process for the following. Table 4.03.23D, those are the supplemental standards for an outdoor recreation use. Mr. Knutson can meet all of those standards outside of two. Those two are, he's asking for variance to the setback of 150 feet from all property lines, and the minimum buffer, which they're asking that he meets 1.5 times the normal buffer requirement, plus add a wall or fence. He's also asking for a variance to Chapter 4.07.04, which is our general landscaping regulations. He's also asking for variance to Chapter 4.07.06, which pertains to our minimum buffer requirements. And he will also be asking for a variance to Table 6.01.038, which pertains to parking spaces. Specifically, in regards to Table 4.03.23D, the outdoor recreation areas, in regards to 150 feet from any property line, Mr. Knutson will be able to meet the 150 feet from the northern property line, which is a property line that he shares with the rear of the homes in the Crestwood subdivision. It will be the west lot line, which backs up to the railroad track, that he will be asking for a variance of 100 feet. He's actually proposing 50 feet. And I apologize, I can't see that. I don't know if you all can. The west lot line is the rear line, and it backs up to the railroad track. The south lot line backs up to a heavily wooded vacant track, which consists of approximately 144 acres. And the east lot line is the front yard, which runs parallel with Bemis Knights Academy Road. From the front line, he's proposing 100 feet. He will be asking for a 50 feet variance on the front yard. On the side yard, which is the south lot line, he's proposing 50 feet, which he's asking for variance on the south property line. And the rear, he's proposing 50 feet, so he will be asking for variance of 100 feet. In regards to both landscaping and buffer, he's asking for a variance in its entirety to both the landscaping requirement plus the request for the fence or wall. In regards to landscaping, Mr. Knutson would be required to landscape a minimum of 3.6 acres or 158,000 plus square feet of his development site with sod or some type of ground cover. And he would have to implement a total of 146 trees. Those are the requirements for the landscaping, and those he's asking to for variance to the entire thing. In regards to the buffer, the buffer would be along the north lot line, normally in this case, a buffer would be 30 feet wide if the code is required that he's 1.5 feet more than the norm. It would be a 40 foot wide buffer along the north and south property lines. Along that north property line, which is the line that abuts up to the rear of the homes in Crestwood subdivision, he would be required to plant a minimum of 93 trees, 583 shrubs. And similarly, on the south lot line, which is the line adjacent to that vacant lot of 144 acres, he would be required to plant 95 trees, 597 shrubs. Again, Mr. Knudsen is asking to utilize the trees and vegetation already existing on site and seeking relief to both the pool landscaping and minimum buffer and the fence or wall requirement. Lastly, the parking is calculated by the acreage of active use of the development. In his proposal, Mr. Knudsen will be using approximately around 18 acres. Once calculated by staff, I believe the code says for every 1,000 feet of active area. However, I did that, y'all. I'm tired. This is a long case. 800 parking spaces is what was required. And so Mr. Knudsen is proposing to utilize a 1 acre tract in the front of the existing home to prepare a parking lot that will consist of 50 regular parking spaces and 2 handicap parking spaces. And he is asking for a variance for the approximate 748 parking spaces. Mr. Knudsen has expressed that finances is the biggest culprit in trying to develop according to the ULDC in regards to the parking. He did say that he does not feel that there will ever be a time that there is more than 50 people on site. The TRC discussed this request for several weeks. No one had any negative comments. However, they did recommend, should the Zoning Board of Appeals decide to approve Mr. Knudsen's request, that they do so with the following condition. And it reads, should the need for additional parking become evident, the applicant will provide the same on-site according to county staff's recommendation.
Yes, please.
About the buffering and the cutting down of trees and replacing with other trees, we've had other cases where there's already significant, like we went out there and counted the trees that are in that buffer area, that there's already 96 trees and 87 shrubs or whatever the number was, holding up that area.
The question is, have we mandated that they take the trees down and replant?
Can they just count what's out there?
Sure.
They can just count what's out there.
Yes.
So they don't actually need relief then, because they have, from this aerial, they obviously have trees.
And that is what he's asking to do.
Well, but that wouldn't be relief. That would just be
there. In regards to the buffer goes by the lines. I'm sorry, and I know I'm just sharing your question. The buffer goes by the lines. And so the buffer is what you're doing there. You're separating two different uses. So the folks in Crestwood, I'm not sure what that zoning is versus our commercial.
Right.
So we would actually plant along.
But if he's already got trees in there.
If he has a significant number of trees, yes ma'am, they can be counted.
They can be counted. Yes. So he doesn't have to cut them down. So he actually doesn't need relief.
No. I cannot give you I know what you're saying to me, Ms. Gretchen, but I can't answer it. Because I did not go
you
out
didn't go
there.
Out and count the trees.
Right.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
Would he only need relief if he fell short 35 trees and he
yes.
has to come back?
Yes.
The
exactly.
Anyone have questions? We've may have questions in a few minutes.
Yes, sir.
All right. Is anyone here the proposed operator, developer, or someone to speak on his behalf?
My name is Josh Mason. I live at 5133 Rockingport Road, Dallas, Georgia. And I guess just to sort of add on, I guess first thing for being here and hearing this case is a chance to speak on this. Just to add on a little bit of what Deborah's already told you, you know, obviously there's tons of trees there. To get us this buffer that we want when we finesse in there. But I guess the main thing would be the fence. Concerns me. You know, when we first took on this project, we wanted to bring two goals to life. You know, number one, make sure that anybody in the neighborhood is ultimately not affected visually, safety-wise, audibly, any of that. And then also not really have a big environmental footprint on the property itself. You know, we're not going to live forever. Other generations are going to use this property. Lots of it grow. We don't know what that looks like in the future. So we don't want to come through here, clear cut a bunch of areas, take down a whole bunch of trees that have been there for a long time. So I guess on that buffer, you know, we can meet that requirement. There's plenty of trees there, but we don't want to tear down trees to put fence up. Within the site code that I've given you, I'm sure this one will be impacted. What we're proposing is, I guess, just to stick by code on the northern line of the property. And then when the activity area actually starts, we're going to put up a 20-foot net. So you have half a football field of dense woods that will be between us and them, along with the 20-foot net. There won't be any loudspeakers, there won't be anything, you know, simulating battle noises. I'm going to stick with the code that you guys have for noise and light, because I know that's important. We don't want to keep people awake. We don't want to bother people on the weekends.
What are the hours of operation?
So the hours of operation that we currently have, if we're not in business, but this is sort of what we're thinking, Fridays, 5 to 9:30. Saturday, we're going to work at 9 in the morning to 7 in the afternoon. And then Sunday from 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. Now, the reason for Friday night is we're going to have a different type scenario going on Friday night. Just like you have regular laser tag that's with lights, you have a laser tag that's in the dark. So this will be in the dark, but in some of these areas that are secluded further away from the neighborhood, we'll have it lit. But again, we're going to stick with code and make sure that any of these lights doesn't encroach on any of the property lines. So we're staying with the code, but that's the original operation. And I can give that to you if you want.
How lighting system will come up? I mean, except to light up the football field?
No. So we're looking at, I guess, fog lights, you'd say, or floodlights at your house. And we're going to try to keep them low. That's where they're not, you know, any higher than any trees or any structures that are there. And our plan is, and I didn't really want to get this out, it's not going to be white light. It's going to be green light. And the reason for that is we want to simulate night vision. You know, not every kid can afford night vision, but they all think it's cool. So what we want to do is simulate night vision. And again, it's going to be probably 500 feet from these people's house, or the property line. And what we'll want to do is just small lights that can also give them area to see what they want to do, but also simulate night vision. So it's not going to be a sharp white light. It's going to be hardly visible at all. It actually won't be visible at all on any property line. We're sticking with that code.
How will electricity get to these lights?
I plan on sticking with code to that. I'm not an electrician, so I can't say exactly how it will go, but it will be 100% safe and up to code on how the electricity will run these lights, whether it's, you know, ground or if we use solar power. I would assume solar power would probably be our best bet, but I don't want to rule out any other opportunities if solar power just doesn't work.
I have a question about the setback against the two that you're requesting, the 50 foot instead of 150 feet along those two edges. The property clearly is large enough to accommodate that. Is there some distance that these guns shoot that from edge to edge shoots too far?
No. And with the netting that we'll have in place, it will stop any of that. The only reason I asked for a setback on the southern and western and eastern side, just to give us more of a chance to pull away from the neighborhood. I've already spoken with Eric Rounds, who owns the land on the southern part, and he owns the land on the eastern part. And I explained to him in detail this site plan, told him that it's gonna be 50 feet from the property line, if it's approved. And he said, you know, this, he's an appraiser, from what I understand. He tells me that this won't affect his property or any of his future plans from what he did. So we're asking for that so we can have more area for the neighborhood. If we have to do 150 feet center cut on that, you know, like you said, the area is large enough to do that. We have some wetlands that we also try to stay away from. So any extra area that we have to stay away from that in the neighborhood is just helpful. Because that is sort of one of the
Thank you.
I have a question.
Certainly.
I'm not familiar with this type of regulation, so I want to know something about the noise level. What these guns that are used sound-wise, what would that be the equivalent to a real gun?
Even silence weapons that you see on TV are louder than these weapons.
So they have no sound, basically?
Basically, have you ever shot a BB gun, a basic BB gun?
I did.
It's the same thing. So these toys are no louder than that. It's the same technology. With springs or air, or if you've heard a paintball gun shoot, it's about the same noise level that exactly. It's the same technology.
Okay, why is it required to have a netting for safety purposes?
So, number one, the netting, you want to have a visual barrier for anybody who's taking part in it to know where they can and can't go. So that also helps with that. The netting, you know, will stop anything going into that buffer area. So that's more reason, you know, why I don't have it, you know, somebody wants to jump the fence and trespass on our property, then they're in that buffer zone, and they will still be protected from these projectiles because they're in the net. So we're trying to protect that as much as possible. If you go to Tallahassee or Virginia, you see these other facilities that are inside cities and sometimes on the outskirts like this would be, they don't have any woods. They have just nets. So they don't have any woods. So their nets are 20 feet high and they go around the property like we want to do. But we are going to have woods on top of that.
So what you're saying is most of these other places are located more in a commercial area.
Some are. Some indoor arenas are. Some are closer to town than others. There are, there's an example in Myrtle Beach that's within other commercial, indoor residences and that's next to it. So they're not all within the city. There are.
What's the distance on the projectile in terms of shield?
How far can it go? It all really depends on, you know what. You got an expensive toy or a baseline toy, but I would say no more than that football field, if that.
Does the netting prevent it from going as trespassing on somebody else's property?
Netting 100% stops that.
What size net is on the netting?
So the netting will be less than, I believe, 4 millimeters. So these BBs are 8 millimeters, 9 millimeters in diameter. The net will be professional grade, it will be, you know, what condition trainer requires, and it'll stop the numbers.
Will it be anchored to the ground in such a way that if somebody crossed your property line to go see what's going on or whatever, that they could not readily crawl under it?
So yes, so there's rivets, if you will, on the bottom of the nets.
They would be staked in such a way that the average person could walk up there and slide his hand under it and pull it up and get 2 foot off the ground, foot and a half off the ground, they could crawl up under it and get in there. Is it going to be netted all four sides?
So I guess that really depends on what your rule is today. We don't feel that it should be, and along Eric Ross's property line on the south side, I told him that the net would be going across the entire property line. It would actually just cover the north, come down to the east side, and then also cover a portion of this property, sort of just cut it off a little bit. And he understands that and wants that because obviously there's, you know, not playing or enjoying this activity, that, you know, wildlife can still come and go through it. This is something that he enjoys and is concerned with. So, you know, we don't plan to cover the entire property line, but we can if we need to, but from what we see, it's not needed. We just plan on protecting the residential spaces.
The other one that you have been to and looked at, were they fenced on four sides?
They were not. They only used the net.
Not, well, I'm sorry. Were they netted on all four sides?
No. They were netted in the area that was facing the road, facing their pro shop, but whenever they were in their actual property that butted up against this woods, there was not. So in those areas where you know where you were going is either visual markers or woods that you just can't simply walk through as
are the bullets biodegradable? I mean, do they dissolve in rain? I mean, what's the deal? What's the environmental impact on these things if they were going to metals problem?
Sure. So some BBs are not biodegradable. Our plan, not plan, what we will be doing is requiring that everybody who visits our facility purchases BBs from us. We will make sure they're all biodegradable. Some people will say that they're more expensive and harder to obtain. That's not the case. The wholesaler that I have has them at the same price as the other BBs. So I'll be able to afford our customers that same savings, and they'll see why they need these versus just ones that won't.
What is it that we're shooting at?
Each other. So just like some video games or paintball, you know, it's a sport where you want to.
But you're shooting a BB gun at you.
Sure.
When I'm right next to you, does that hurt?
So if you're good enough to get right next to somebody, it may hurt a little bit, but the safety equipment that we'll be suggesting that everybody use, also, you know, we can't control what clothes they wear. We control whether they have face masks or shoes or anything along those lines. If they're wearing a straight up t-shirt and they don't mind it, and they miss it, may hurt a little bit. But in this size area, they're not going to be on top of each other like this. They're going to be further away. And then really, sometimes they may not even notice that they're hit. And some people might say they were cheating because they didn't even call that they were hit. And they just simply didn't know.
Out of the 36 acres, what percentage is going to be used as recreation?
So we're going to use 18 acres approximately for it. I'm not sure what that percentage is. So if you look at that package you have, I think there's something on there with zoning. So if you see the R21 zoning area, the blue portion of it is what will be used for activity. And the green portion is what will be used for parking. And, you know, I'm gonna have my family living there. My mom, my dad, my grandmother, my four brothers and sisters. So my number one concern is safety as well.
Okay, clarification. Step up here for a second. Okay, you're saying blue is going to be where they're actually participating in the
process.
Green is where you're going to park the vehicle.
Yes.
And where's the residence going?
The residence is approximately right there in between.
Okay.
So everything else will be unused. My family's going to be living there. So that's approximately 10 acres, 10 and a half acres that won't be used for any activity at all, which I guess would affect that fence that would be going across the north side. Yeah, there won't even be any activity going on there. Like I said, my 7-year-old grandmother will be living there, my mom and dad. I have 7 brothers and sisters, 4 of which stay at home, 2 are under 7 years old. So, again, one of our goals is to make sure it's 100% safe for them, and they're gonna be closer than anybody else. So if it's 100% safe for them, then it's definitely gonna be even more so for anybody who's further.
We're trying to remember here that what we're dealing with is your variances.
Sure.
The buffering, the setback, the park.
So, I guess, on the fence, you know, we're looking at tearing up what's already established vegetation to kind of wrap the fence, when there's already a fence on the northern property, or on the northern line that is neighborhoods. So just be airing it there and out, and in my opinion, really won't affect anything as far as lines or projectiles, because that's already being stopped within the completed area. We have half the football field of dense woods that are going to be doing the same job. So I just my request so that I don't have to tear up trees just to put the fence. I don't think it will actually be necessary. On the parking lot, I understand that code is in place for a lot of things, something that's, you know, larger like that has a lot of people visiting that. So you have to have that in place. But what I project is maybe 5,200 people showing up, and most of the time they're car full, the kids that can't even drive, or young adults that have parents coming with them. So I estimate 50 cars at most showing up. There was a national arena here in town a couple of years ago. Yeah, I don't think that had more than 15 cars showing up. I mean, it seemed to be pretty successful at the time. And so I think doubling that or more than doubling that would be more than adequate for what people were going to ask from here. 800 spaces would just be too large for what we're proposing here. It would take up several acres and probably counterproductive to there's a lot. They don't want, you know, a bunch of development, nor do I. So that's why I'm just going to ask.
Any other questions? If we grant these variances, they go with the property, not with the owner. Is that correct? So they would be granted in perpetuity.
Yes, that's correct.
Deborah?
Yes, sir.
Can't we put wording in there that should these owners sell the property, that these variances at that point would die?
Yes, sir. Sure.
And should they sell it to somebody who wanted to continue the operation, that person would then still be able to come back and ask for variance for their operation at that point.
If that's the boy's desire, yes, he has
to be. I just wanted that in a minute, because that's pretty much the way I remember.
Yes, sir.
What happens if your fence comes down? Does anybody come out and inspect you on a regular basis to see that it's in place? Because most of what we approve or what comes to light is complaint driven.
Right.
And you've got a 36-acre tract of land out there that people are not going to be inspecting. Do you have inspectors or regulators that in this industry?
I don't believe that there are that regulated any more than what Miles County would. Just like you said, Miles County has an enforcement team, I'm sure that would be.
They don't go out on a regular basis.
But it's on a complaint basis. So, I mean, anybody who would be visiting that kid here, parents who have been concerned, this will be 100% transparent. So, I guess the answer to your question is, everybody that will be visiting, all parents that will be visiting that want to be safe, will make sure I'm in check.
I'm thinking more about your neighbors.
Sure. Well, they won't be able to see. You know, I'm trying to make it to where on every property line, even the one with 50 feet, enough dense wood, which you can't see the activity. You know, in this day and age, a lot of concerns are with what are weapons or maybe sports that look like weapons. My plan is to enforce that any visitors that bring their own toys, have them in a bag. And whenever they come on the property, they come in the pro shop, they pay to participate, then they take their bag to a staging area where they get ready for the games, and then they pull their toys out and get them ready for the game. And then when they're ready to leave, they put them back in the bags, and they go on their way. So virtually, if you're not participating in the activity, you won't see, hear, or be affected by this whatsoever.
Are you going to have a setup where those bags are inspected to make sure that they are appropriate weapons?
Correct. So when they come to the pro shop and they purchase their entry, they will then go to somebody who will inspect everything, make sure that it's what needs to be, it's not shooting too far, make sure the bags and sell everything. So they'll cut them out and then give them a stamp approval if they're good, or the nine if they're not, and give them a chance to come and rent something that is appropriate.
Pro shop is apparently going to be somewhat adjacent or near to the park.
Correct.
So that when they park, there will be a path that says, go this way.
Correct.
And it will go to the pro shop, and then they will actually have to go into the pro shop to gain access to the rest of it, so it will then potentially, in my mind, everything would be netted from the pro shop all the way around back to the pro shop, and the only entrance to get in or out would be through the pro shop.
That is correct. Are they going to sign some type of waivers of liability?
They are. And we would be fully insured as well.
Do you have insurance on the property?
Well,
you guys have liability insurance?
So I don't currently own the property, so I don't right now. But when we purchase the property, we will have liability insurance. We will have umbrella policy, whether that's $1 million, $2 million, whatever we have counsel on that we feel would be the best. Maybe in certain instances in other cities that may have these same type of things, and get their counsel on what would be the best, but we'll be fully insured to cover any that we feel would be best.
Back to the netting. If you put the netting up, starting at one side of the pro shop and going all the way around and coming back, and it is anchored like we were discussing, so people can't sneak in.
Yes.
How are you going to facilitate wildlife that may be inside when you put the netting up or whatever?
So what I was saying earlier on Eric Roush's concern, like I said, with wildlife, is that the entire property won't be enclosed in that for the purpose of wildlife to be able to come and go. But we will place the netting in places that will affect any residences or streets or anything like that, and then come into the more wooded zone, a couple hundred feet, maybe more, to make sure that, like you said, no one more visitors are coming. But then again, wildlife that can traverse dense woods can come and go over the place.
What would happen if people shoot wildlife?
I don't think it would. I've seen videos of cool people shooting squirrels with airsoft weapons, and the squirrels, flinch, like they're not being hurt, like you would see with pelican, firepower, designed to it may put a lock on, but it's not a thing to watch.
What happens if some of the wildlife eat the pellets?
Then it's biodegradable, so it'll just break down or something.
We made earlier that you could use existing trees. Do you have any idea of how you're going to determine how many trees are there versus what would be potentially required, and that one minus the other leaving so some total that might have to be planted, that we could then say, we'll give you a variance on this much or that much, instead of just giving you open carte blanche to.
Sure, so I guess in that case, we could square off, square some of the square feet, and count the trees that are within it, and I guess calculate that based off of the property lines, and give you a rough idea of how many trees are out there. I can tell you right now, on those property lines, unless you have a machete or something to get you through those woods, you're not allowed to do this. And you do, you're gonna come off pretty scratched up, because it's extremely wet.
Is it net and camo?
It's black. So, even if you look, you know, look at the view, you should be able to see it, through those woods.
Deborah?
Yes, sir.
If there are trees inside the net, does that count toward the buffer within the distance requirement? Are they gonna have to count only what is outside the net?
The buffer is purposed to be situated along the line of the property.
Okay. Where I'm going is, yeah, we're supposed to start at the property line and come in with however many feet.
Yes.
Of setback, however many feet of buffer and however many trees in the buffer.
Okay, yes.
But once you reach that net, then the buffer should stop there. They can't.
Right.
They can't count trees on the inside.
Yes, sir. You're right. I see where you're going with that.
On chapter 74074, about the landscaping.
Yes, sir.
Natural trees in the natural environment of a forest is landscaping?
Yes.
Okay, so they don't need relief on that either, because they have landscape, it's trees.
What we did is, we went to that outdoor recreation table, and within that table, it talks about, well, one, we're doing landscaping because it is a new project. It's a new project. So all new projects will require landscaping. Not all projects will require buffers. Buffers, we're looking at our use against the different zoning districts. So in this case, we will be doing landscaping because it is a new project. The landscaping tells us to take 10% of the gross land area, and that's your sod, grass, ground cover, for every
But if he has 36 acres of woods, that is by definition landscape.
I understand what you're saying to me. Why do we ask for the landscaping? I'm not quite sure.
Maybe it's for
that we do have the numbers that we need listed. So if Mr. Knutson can verify that we meet them.
Okay, thank you.
Within the netting. And I'm using that to determine where you're actually going to be doing this. As time progresses and the people are stomping and carrying on through there, trees would probably be, without a doubt, probably not effective to speak of. But other landscaping type stuff probably don't take a severe beating over a period of time.
I would say you're 100% correct.
Eventually, you could end up with lots of trees and virtually nothing on ground cover.
I would say you're 100% correct if the activity is going on every day during all business hours with heavy traffic. But I don't think that that would be the case in this. I visited larger airsoft fields that don't turn to complete dirt, but the grass is still there. I guess it would just be anybody's yard with the ground to play in. They don't spend 100% of the time there, so it doesn't tear it up. And I don't think that we will have that case.
Anybody have any other questions at this time?
I guess what I'd like to make sure that you guys understand is that, you know, obviously there are people here that oppose it. They're going to say why it shouldn't happen at all. You know, you guys already know that the majority of properties are zoned where they need it. And, you know, if we, you know, stick the code, we can go and, you know, get this rolling. But I want you to know that, you know, we've already touched on safety, visibility, noise, environment. And I have met every questionnaires on that to make sure that we're sure I'm heard, unseen, unaffected at every property line. I have a person who lives on the property line in Crestwood who knew this was going in place before he purchased his home. And he purchased his home at full price, didn't ask for a discount, and continued to live there knowing that we plan to put this here. He even sent me a letter, which I can give you guys, just stating that, stating that support. And that while you have maybe some people saying that, you know, there will be visual weapons and people with PTSD that will be affected by this, just know that if you're not in the activity area, the only way you're going to know this is here is by seeing the sign out front. And that's our number one goal, to make sure that everybody is well taken care of.
I've got one more question. You said it had already been rezoned. Was that a recommendation of the planning commission?
I'm sorry, it wasn't already rezoned. It was already zoned to Riffage Agricultural. It's 36 acres.
Right, but it has not been. You need a new zoning, right?
No. So 22 acres is already zoned the way we need it. So we can use it today.
Right.
With that R21, we plan to use a portion of it for parking and a portion of the activity area. And the main goal for that is so we can pull this activity area away from the neighborhood. If we're not able, if they don't pronounce the zoning on the 11th for that, then that pushes us into that orange area and forces us ultimately to push our activity area closer to the neighborhood. You know, right after that, we're going to try to stay away from the neighborhood as much as possible, even further than what I've explained to you guys. And if we don't meet, if we can say 500 feet from the neighborhood, we will, and if we're successful in building that area, we won't use it. But I can tell you this, you know, if we don't get that zoning, then we'll just ultimately push us closer to the neighborhood, which I know some of these people definitely wouldn't want.
You said you had a letter in support of one person?
So I gave you guys the petition that was signed. I think by over 60 people, and I only started that this morning just because I found out that the neighborhood was signed one, so I figured I would get one going as well. And under 4 hours, I had 61 signatures. Last night I put a post on Facebook, and I think it was around 50 or 60 people that showed support for it. So if I really got out of the community, went to the colleges, and people that would actually be in the ones, I guarantee I'd get over 1,000 signatures.
But I do have to say this.
Yeah.
The 60 people that you've got, some of these people live in Ray City. Some of these people live in Lake Park. They are not affected.
Sure. But
these are potential people that will be customers. But the people that are affected are the ones that we really need to be looking at.
Sure. So I have one of those people, and if you look at the... If you look at that zone, you know, the activity area is right here. So the main people that would be affected are these people. These people won't be butted up against any activity area. They'll be living next to my family in something that won't even be used. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. One of them, you know, knew this was going in place, and I've got the letter right here. Those people spend money and go off to the criminal office.
I need the one copy that you have, or a copy of the letter that says you didn't support the people in our package. Is it in there?
Uh-huh.
You know what? Apparently we have it in here, that's fine. Okay, any other questions?
Yes.
Any other questions or discussion? Thank you very much. Is there anyone else here in support that would like to speak concerning information that we don't already have? Please come to the lectern. Need your name and address for the record?
Yes, my name is John Thompson. I live at 3865 Hartville Drive. Obviously, we're pretty much just about in line with it. It would be great instead of having it all the way in town to have something like this go to. And then also, in regards to safety, I've been playing airsoft for pretty much my whole life. I'm 20 years old. I've lived in the area 20 years. My brother shot from point blank with a gas powered, which is the highest, you know, a gas powered airsoft gun. Did bleed, all bruised a little bit, and did that a clean away in 10 to 15 seconds. If you knew the area, all these neighborhoods around the area are military. So if their kids don't know how to shoot a weapon, of course, this would be a good place to start. But most of the kids in our military should know how to shoot weapons. So safety, in one regards, should not be a factor. But I would like, instead of having to travel, you know, waste gas, 20 minutes, just be able maybe to ride a bike or run down the road and, you know, check in and use, you know, his safety gear that they provide for us.
Comments, questions? Thank you very much. Yes, is there someone else? And please keep in mind that we're talking about variances. He can do what he wants to do by right now. We're just talking about variances. All right.
Good afternoon. My name is Anthony Swindle. I live here about office 2940 Dogman Circle. I lived here my whole life, and I'm about to get to the variances, but real quick, Ms. Hoggy knows, I grew up with her son. A lot of the young kids around here, they don't have anything like this to it, and like you just said, though, that they can get it either way. And what Mr. Knutson here is trying to do is make sure that this is done in a safe. He's taking everybody's concerns in the play, that he's coming here, he's spending his money to get counseling on this kind of stuff. He's asking people to get petitions, so he's doing his due diligence when he doesn't even have to get this thing running, just to try to keep everybody happy. This is an activity for children. I mean, this isn't something. I just got out of the Marine Corps, 8 years infantry. I deal with PTSD. I deal with clinical depression, all these other things. And so for somebody to say that it's going to trigger one of these, military members somewhere, because they, first of all, they're not going to be seeing. If we look over here, they're not going to be seeing anybody. You know, and like you said, there's specific pipelines to getting even into the activity. I know we mentioned the one that they had in town a few years ago. It was the same way there. They were very strict, very, just like on the Marine Corps. On the range, everything, you know, if you're a safety violator, you're gone, just like that, you know. And the same thing with the last place that he was involved with. They were very straight, very serious. Everybody there is all about safety. And obviously, they're also concerned about the environment. And then looking at this, I haven't even really seen how thick the woods are there until now. But I mean, in my house, a dog would circle, you can pull that up. I too have a tract of woods just like that behind my house. But it's like half of that. And there's a big open field that they're developing for, they're like digging like a big pond and stuff like that. And I don't see or hear anything like that. So I don't think some kids, and these guns are silent. It's like shooting a rubber band or something. You know, they're just quiet. I don't think there's going to be a lot of screaming and yelling going on. It's good exercise. So I think this would be a good thing for the community, for the kids of our community. And I just want to come and pledge my support. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you, sir.
I'm Ron Barber, and I live at 39 West Parker Road in Florida. And I've talked to John several times about this, and I just want everyone to know his first and foremost thing that he's concerned about is that neighborhood. We've had many conversations about it. he is very concerned with that neighborhood and not encroaching on that. And I don't know if everybody here knows that, but we need to know that. We've had very many conversations about that. Also, I've worked with Josh. I've known him for 8 years. In 8 years, I've spent a lot of time with him. He's always showed excellent character. He's never told me a lie. He's never led me in the wrong direction. And if he says that's his biggest concern, I believe him, and that's his biggest concern. And I want to talk about that, but I also wanted to talk about this. I did a little bit of research on the positive effects of aerosol. The number one positive effect it has is it gets young people off the couch. It provides us, he's going to provide a safe and supervised place for them to enjoy. It helps them connect with other children, teaches conflict resolution, creates a community environment, teaches leadership skills. And also, the number one thing that stood out to me that a lot of the airsoft children say is after playing it for a while, they find a deeper respect for our veterans, the people who pay for them. I just want to say that. Thank you.
Ever. Is there anyone else here in support? And please keep in mind, you know, we're not dealing with some of these aesthetics and what we're talking about now. We're dealing with the variants. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Angela. Hi, Vincent. I live at 795 Plantation Drive, Claydale, Georgia. I'm watching my son. And I'm here on behalf of his father today. My husband is working today and had people that were out sick, so he couldn't make it. He is a veteran of the other shore. He has always taught our children to be very safety conscious, especially with any type of guns, being of course reported, but he's raised them to do that. As far as the variances go, we are going to be buying the house that's on this property. We want to improve this house. There's a lot of money going into renovating this house. My mom, who is 70 years old, has lived with us for the past 5 years. We live in a four-bedroom house right now, and she has a very small bedroom with kind of an outside home outside of her room. This dwelling place has a full mother and a suite on. So when Josh found this property, we were very excited about that part. We have little children still at home, so we are very, you know, conscious of the safety of all of this. We do want to be a blessing to our neighbors, and we do want to be a blessing to the community. We own a business as well right now, and so we understand that, you know, that as we go into this, some of the variances would create a hardship for financially for some of these things that might need to be done that are not necessary at this point. With the fence that already exists there, and all the trees that are already there, that provides a better buffer than going and clear-cutting things down. And we want our property to remain beautiful. We want to improve the property. In the front, the home, we want to improve the property values of this neighborhood to the north of us. We want to be good neighbors. That is truly our heart's desire, is to be good neighbors, to improve the value of the property, to be able to serve our community and young people who might want to come in and play together or play with father, son, activity. We would love to, you know, just be a light and a mentor to young people in our community. But we do understand the concerns of the neighbors. Yeah, I'm homeowner right now. You know, we understand it, don't really understand what might be going next door. You'd be concerned about your property values. I totally sympathize with that. That is why we are trying to beautify this land and to provide all the buffers around it so it ensures that no property values are affected. And that my husband is an avid military supporter. He was in the military. He was in the war.